important stats concept that can come up often in genomics, and some of the, I think, key points are good to think about when thinking about statistics in genomics. So basically we're going to cover four main topics. So the first is just sort of setting the stage, outlining, you know, what is a hypothesis test formally, what is a statistic, and then how we use those statistics to calculate p-values. And I guess the main reason for doing that in the context of this class is to then think about when calculating p-values for genomic experiments, what are the big challenges? And one of the main ones is dealing with multiple comparisons, the fact that we're testing so many individual genes, for example. And then on a slightly sort of different note, I'm going to end with some slides on normalization and normalizing data, some different approaches, and how if you're right or wrong, it can sort of really change your interpretation of your experiments. So I'm going to start with there's two or three slides in the beginning that are like really boring. These are like traditional stats slides from, you know, undergrad. But I was going to figure out reprise them anyway. Because I guess, I did my PhD in biostatistics. But until I started my PhD, I'd actually never taken a like statistics class in my whole life. And no one ever told me what a p-value was. So I think this stuff might still be relevant. So much of what we do revolves around, you know, hypothesis testing. And I think some of the terms people use are not always entirely clear. So often we do a hypothesis test because we're interested in the expression level of, say, some gene. We want to know, is this gene different between, you know, condition one and condition two? Is, you know, action different between this set of samples and this set of samples? So I'm going to use mu because statisticians love using mu. I'm not sure why. I think it's because no one else uses mu, and it makes us feel kind of special, maybe. So mu A and mu B are the sort of the true average expression level of this gene in group A and group B, right? And I want to know if these two things are different. So the way we do it is we set up a null hypothesis and an alternative hypothesis. The null hypothesis is that the two levels are exactly the same. Like that's what we're really interested in disproving. And the alternative hypothesis is that they're different in some way. I'm not going to say how they're different, but this is sort of typically the interesting case, right? So to sort of address that hypothesis, we're going to do a test. And essentially all tests in statistics are based on a statistic. And a statistic is just some transformation of the data that you can use to test your hypothesis. So in this case, I'm going to start by defining XA and XB. And that's the average expression of this gene in, you know, my three control samples and my three experimental samples. Right. So mu previously was sort of the true unobservable average expression level of that gene, which we can't actually observe. What you can actually measure is this X, which is, you know, for your actual experiment, in your actual experiment, what are the levels? And then you can take, so the average expression level in group A minus the average expression in group B. And then typically, statistics are constructed very often in this sort of form. You have some sort of difference, and then you divide by some sort of scaling factor. And in this case, we're dividing by the standard error of the difference. So essentially we're saying, how different is A from B relative to the variability in the measurements? So the denominator here is basically going to determine how much randomness you have in your data. So if you have like a really precise system where you always measure the exact same thing very precisely, the denominator is going to be tiny. And then if there's a difference between those two, this overall number is going to be something big. Right. So I guess we can think of it as being, if your difference between the groups is large and your replicability within the groups is very small, you tend to have a large statistic. And the reason we set it up this way is that we always want to create a statistic, like this for example, where we know how it's going to behave if the null hypothesis is true. So I'm going to sort of put some real numbers to this to make it sort of a bit more tangible. So how many R lectures have you got done so far?
Two.
Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically create some fake data for an experiment where I have five replicates in each group. So five control samples that are A and five experiment samples that are B. And I'm going to tell R to give me five random numbers. And the average in both of the groups of those numbers should be 10. Standard deviation is going to be 1. Right? So this is the situation where the null hypothesis is actually true. Right? Five random numbers here, five random numbers there, but there should be no difference between them. And then I'm just going to calculate the difference in the means. And typically, if that difference were large, I would say, ha, it looks like the null hypothesis is false. Right? Alternatively, if the alternative hypothesis is true, so there really is a difference between these two groups, in that case, that's what I'm simulating down here. So I'm still doing five samples in each group, but now the mean in one group is 12, the mean in the group is 10. Right, so in this case, there is actually a true difference. And then for each of these scenarios, I'm going to do this 10,000 times. So I'm pretending I'm essentially doing my experiment 10,000 times over and looking at what these values turn out to be, these differences in the means. And might be a bit small, you get something like this. So the black line here represents what you might see if the null hypothesis is true. There's no real difference, right? So the x-axis here shows the observed difference between A and B. And this is how frequently you see each of those differences. So because this black line, which is the null, is centered on 0, it means like the most common difference you'll see is something very close to 0. Right? Every once in a while, you'll see something that suggests A is much lower. Sometimes you'll see something that suggests A is much higher. But typically, it's going to be something over here. So that then brings us to the concept of a p-value. So imagine you do this experiment. You're not doing it 10,000 times, right? You're only doing it once. And then from that one time you do it, you get some sort of measurement. So imagine you see 0.5 is the difference you observe. And then you want to know, given that I did the experiment and I saw 0.5, can I say there's a difference or not? Can I reject the null hypothesis? And that's where the p-value comes in. So the definition of the p-value is just what's written there. It's basically, what's the probability that, assuming the null hypothesis is true, so there's nothing going on, that you'd observe something as extreme as what you did, or even more extreme. So for example, say you observed A was 1 unit higher than B. So that represents something sort of along here on this axis. So the p-value is basically the area under this black curve over on this side. Right? Because everything happening here is more extreme. You could have observed 2, you could have observed 10. Those are all more extreme than what you did. So the area under this curve here is essentially the p-value. It's the fraction of this area that's more extreme than what you observed. So that's why you can tell that if you observe something that was 2, the area would be just this part down here, right? Which corresponds to a smaller p-value, because your observation was more extreme. So say, what's the chance of this? What's the likelihood? What's the probability that this happened by chance? There's nothing going on. So if I look at those, so here, for example, I'm saying, how many of those 10,000 experiments I did saw a value that was greater than 1. So A is, the average of A is 1 unit higher than the average of B. And that happens 5.6% of the time. Right, so that means that if I see a value of 1, my p-value is actually 0.005. Right, that's directly where the p-value comes from. If instead I saw a difference of 2, then I'm going to say, what's the area here? And that's a much smaller number, right? The chance of this happening, if there's nothing going on, is pretty tiny. which is why if you see something this small, you typically can reject the null and say, I'm pretty sure there's something going on because this probably wouldn't have happened if there was nothing there. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So essentially all statistical tests, so in this case we did something like, we do something like a t-test, where you take a difference in the means. Pretty much any other test you do always comes back to a statistic. And the idea is that we know what this distribution looks like for that statistic if the null is true. So if you're not doing a if you're doing a chi-square test, for example, the shape will be different. But the key is that it's known for that particular test. So you can just compare your value to this shape and say, what is your direct p-value? So that works really well if you're looking at, you know, I'm talking about comparing one gene across conditions here. Typically, we're comparing many, many genes in genomics, and that's where sort of things get a bit trickier, which is sort of the most important stuff I'm going to get to. Actually, before that, I just want to put in one sort of side note. So we're talking about, you know, statistical significance here. So if the p-value is below some threshold you set, you can say there's a statistically significant difference between the groups. But I think a key thing to keep in mind is that we need to consider both statistical significance, which people like myself like, and then biological significance. Like, does it actually matter? And the reason that is, so this, imagine now that this is the figure we looked at before. If, as you increase your sample size, your estimates become more and more accurate, which basically corresponds to, so before you sometimes saw a value of -2, sometimes you saw a value of +2, not very often, but it happened. That's if you had, you know, 5 replicates in each group. If instead I had 100 replicates in each group, all that sort of experimental biological variability gets shrunken down. You get something that's much, much tighter. So in that case, you're almost never going to see a difference of 1 if there's nothing going on. So what this does is that it essentially increases your power to detect very small differences. Because imagine the true difference is 0.5. So the true difference, if this is the scenario here, that's actually kind of hard to detect, because 0.5 looks like what you might observe just by random chance. If you had 100 replicates, you're essentially never going to see that, right? So increasing sample size obviously increases your power to find small differences. But I think one thing that's important is that you may not care about it. So that comes up, I think, in, for example, with people doing all these single-cell RNA-seq studies now. You can have 1,000 cells in one group, 1,000 cells in the other group. You can potentially detect very small differences, but if the fold change is like 0.01 difference, it may be statistically significantly different, but do you actually care? As in, do you believe there's some biological phenotype associated with that difference? Which this is not going to tell you. That's a purely sort of biological interpretation. So, and I just put this in because I think that's important to sort of keep in mind. Okay. So now I'm getting sort of back to the crux of what I want to talk about. This idea of multiple comparisons. So we talked about p-values for one gene. Typically, if you're doing a gene expression analysis, you're looking at, you know, 20,000 genes or 80,000 different transcripts. And you want to know if any of those is different from one group to the next. So I put like a question up here. So imagine we're back, okay, so we're looking at the one gene scenario. You have a 0.05 cutoff you're going to use. And imagine there's no real difference. So what's the chance that you'll actually do an experiment and then conclude that, yes, there's a difference between these two groups in that scenario? Like, what's the percent chance that you'll essentially call a false positive when there's nothing going on?
5%.
Exactly, 5%. And then, so now imagine the other scenario where there's 20,000 genes. None of them is actually different, because whatever your perturbation is doesn't actually do anything. And you use the same 0.05 cutoff, how many false positives do you expect to make in this scenario?
1,000.
Exactly. It's basically 1,000. Exactly. You call 1,000 things differentially expressed if you use 0.5 threshold and there's nothing going on. So I'm going to make some sort of fake data in R to sort of illustrate that point. So here I'm creating a matrix of completely random numbers. So this R norm function generates random, normally distributed numbers. And I'm saying that I want 10,000 of these times 6, because I'm imagining that I have 10,000 genes and I have 6 samples, 3 in group 1, 3 in group 2. So I'm saying, give me this matrix, make it 6 columns, and then label the columns A1, A2, A3, B1, B2, B3 for group A and group B. So the matrix looks like this, right? But there's no signal here, this is all just random noise. And now I'm going to take this data and do a differential expression test between group A and group B. Which we don't have to go into the details of the code, but essentially what I'm doing here is I'm basically telling R that the groups, the first three are the same group, and the next three are in the second group. And then I'm telling it to do a t-test on each row. So it's going to do 10,000 t-tests. And then calculate the p-value for each of those rows. So I'm going to get 10,000. So I create this vector of called p-val, which is going to be length 10,000, because I've calculated 10,000 p-values, one for each row. And it might look something like this, right? All these p-values are going to be between 0 and 1. And essentially, for any statistical test, if the p-values are well behaved, and you look at the way they're distributed between 0 and 1, they essentially should have this shape. You expect a uniform distribution of p-values between 0 and 1 if the null hypothesis is true. So, and that's where this 5% false positive thing comes from. Because you're saying you can essentially set your cutoff for where you're going to accept something as being different, any way you like along here. And as you set that, you essentially adjust your the false positive rate you're willing to accept. So in this case, if you set this line here is at 0.05. So if that's the case, because this is uniform, 5% of the random times you do this, you'll end up with a p-value of less than that. Right? And so in this case, when I look at it, I ask how many of these p-values are less than 0.05? 497 of our 10,000. So clearly that's not good, right? Now we call 500 things positive, the differential expressed, and there's nothing there. So we obviously have to think about it a bit differently. Now I'm going to make it slightly more interesting. So I'm saying, I still have my 10,000 genes, but now imagine 100 of them are actually differentially expressed. So all I'm doing up here, this first row, so here I'm saying I'm taking, have you done subsetting in matrices? No. So it essentially takes,
We did subsetting, but we'll have to go over a refresher
in the makeup session.
I can't like
remember column 1, 2, 3, comma 1, 3 is a subset, or one. Basically, you're specifying in the brackets 1 to 100 rows and 1 to 3 columns. That's
so
how.
Yeah. So this thing here basically means exactly. This is essentially the first 100 genes, the first 100 rows, and the first 3 columns, which is essentially group A. And I'm saying replace all those values with, this is the same thing as this, but just add 8 to them randomly, right? So now those, exactly, those first 100 are not going to be different expressed because they're 8 units higher in group A. And then I'm just redoing exactly the t-test code I did on the previous slide. So I do t-test again, calculate the p-values, and now I say how many of my p-values are less than 0.05? And in this case, I get 594. Then before it was about 500, and now it's roughly 100 more, but essentially because this is a kind of a huge difference, so all the p-values for those differentiated strings are going to be really small, but I still have my 500 false positives from before. So if you look at the p-value histogram here, it's now mostly flat, but it has like a little bump up here. Right? And this bump is because I have some true positives that are here, right, mixed in with my other false positives. So in this case, of the 600 things you call different, only 100 are actually true. which obviously again is not a great scenario. So and you can imagine that the way to balance, so with these setting your p-value threshold, all you're really doing is trading false positives for false negatives. Right? You can accept more false negatives if you also get more false positives. You have to just choose some balance between the two. That sort of makes sense. And what makes sense, I think, depends kind of on what you're doing. So there's basically different ways you can choose where to set this threshold. So 0.05, based on this, we can say it's probably too lenient, right? Because you get like 80% of your calls are false positives. You probably want something more stringent. Conversely, you've probably identified essentially all of the differentially expressed genes here. So your sensitivity is close to 100%. Right? But that may not be great because you have so many false positives. So you probably want to sort of dial it a bit so that you get, maybe you will detect all of the two differences, but your false positive rate will be something more acceptable. So there's a few different ways of doing that. One adjustment that's really common for multiple testing is something called the Bonferroni adjustment, which people use, typically not in genomics, I'll show you why, but it works very well if you're doing a small number of hypothesis tests. So say you're comparing three hypotheses, and you want to know if any of them, if you can reject any of them. So in that case, if you use the 0.05 threshold, your chance of making a mistake is going to be higher than 5% because you're doing this multiple times, right? You have 5% chance of first time, second time, and third time. So one way to get around that is to take your threshold, 0.05, and divide it by the number of tests you're doing. So if you're doing three tests, you can just take, instead of, say, calling 0.05 the threshold, you're going to do 0.05 divided by 3. And that now is the threshold for calling something significant. And if you do that, you're guaranteed that you're still protected at the 5% rate for your whole experiment across all three tests. Does that make sense?
So
when you're doing one gene at a time, you say you want to control the chance of making an error for that one gene. Mm-hmm. If you're doing many genes, you want to control the chance that you're going to make a mistake across any of them. Right? Your whole paper has three hypothesis tests, and you want there to be only 5% chance that the paper is saying something wrong, because you're testing three things. So you basically have to make each individual test more stringent, such that overall, you only have this 5% chance of saying something is there when it's not. So this Bonferroni adjustment, you just divide your significance level by the number of tests. Works well if you're doing a handful of things. But if you're testing 20,000 genes, it essentially makes the test very, very stringent. Because you have 0.05 divided by 20,000, which is like 10 to the minus 6. So in that case, if you report 100 genes as being different, that's great. They're probably all true. But you're probably missing the vast majority of things that are different, because you've dialed the sort of balance between false positives and false negatives so stringently that you're probably throwing out most of your real signal.
Is there a range where you can think of the Bonferroni, like up to this many hypotheses?
So I guess it's a good question. I don't know if I'd, in practice, if it's more than 10 to 100.
Okay, yep.
It's probably still reasonable.
Okay.
Once you start going into the thousands, I definitely say you're probably not, it's probably not a good option.
Yeah.
So an alternative between, so those are sort of two extremes. One is you use 0.05, like we did first, you get tons of false positives. The other one is you use Bonferroni, and you throw out almost all of your true differences. So somewhere in between, you can get to using this method called the false discovery rate. And the idea of the false discovery rate is that I want to present a list of genes that are differentially expressed, and I want to say that the false positive rate in this set is some percentage that's acceptable. So often people will say, 10% is acceptable. I'm going to give you a list of 200 differentially expressed genes, and I think that 90% of them are true, and 10% of them might be false positives. And that then might be an acceptable balance between sort of reporting as much as you can, but not sort of polluting your signal too much false positives. Let me see. Can I put this up and down easily? Kind of?
Oh, yeah, just...
Is it here?
Yeah, one second.
So, thinking about how we do this forced discovery rate calculation, there's a concept of the Q value, which is analogous to a P value. It's called Q, I think, because Q comes after a P, and it's kind of like a P value, but not really. So imagine you calculated your P values for all of your genes. Right. So you have a list, imagine you have a list of 10,000 P values. From the most significant to the, you rank them from the most significant to the least significant. And then you can essentially calculate from these p-values, you can map them to something that are called q-values. So I won't go into the details of how to do the calculation, but I'm going to go into how, what the interpretation is. So you can imagine that, so just as a sanity check, these Q values tend to be higher values than the P values. And the interpretation of the Q value says that if you take your ranked list of Q values and you set a cutoff at any point you choose, so say you set a cutoff of here, and you're going to call everything above that differentially expressed, the Q value tells you the number of false positives you expect in that set. So if I set my cutoff here, the highest Q value is 0.06, so I expect a 6% false positive rate, or a 6% false discovery rate of these guys up here. So you can, so if you go down to 0.1 and set your threshold, let's set the line there, you have 10%. If you set at 0.01, that's a 1% false discovery rate set. So the false discovery rate essentially is a property of the entire set of results you report as differential. Right. And the Q value is just the way that you choose the threshold for reporting that set.
So first you extract the differentially expressed genes and then you run the FDR.
So
is it the entire?
You do on the entire set, exactly.
Entire set.
So you can, yeah, so there should be about, say there are 20,000 genes, you have 20,000 P values, and from that you calculate 20,000 Q values. So actually, the procedure that estimates Q values needs to see the entire list of P values. And then you just choose what rate is acceptable, and you can filter based on sort of what Q value meaning that threshold.
So how do you go from P to Q?
It's actually non-trivial. And there's a couple of different ways of doing it.
I see.
Which I'm actually not going to attempt to do
Right
now, because that probably wouldn't go well.
Okay.
Suffice to
say, there is some specific procedure to go from P to Q.
There is. And actually, so the simple and not very fair answer to your question is you can use the Q value function in R.
R does
everything.
That's how you do it.
That's
how
you do it. So essentially what this Q value function does, you give it a list of p-values. Imagine this is a vector of p-values, say 20,000 p-values. And you call q-value on that thing. And then this thing here just lets you, it's like an R technicality, but lets you extract the q-values from this calculation. So the output of this basically goes from p-val, which is your p-values, to a q-value vector of the same number of elements. And now I can ask, so going back to our previous example, I want to say that we have, on a 10% false discovery rate. So I'm going to pick everything that has a Q value of less than 0.1. Now asking how many of those things are there. And that tells me that I have 84 things that are significant. So clearly I'm not detecting all my differentially expressed things, because I know I put 100 in there. And I'm only reporting 84, so I'm obviously missing some. But if I instead want to know how many false positives do I have, how many do I really have? Because this 10% is estimated. But because this is simulated data, I actually know what's there. So I can ask, of my top 100 rows, these guys I know are different, right? I can ask how many of these guys were included in my set that I call differential, because they fell below this threshold. I have 72 of them. So 72 of my truly differentially expressed things, I reported out. And then another, I guess, 12 things got called that must have been from the rest of things that aren't actually different. So 12 out of 84 are false positives, right? Which is actually a bit more than 10%. But it's approximately 10%, which is kind of the idea. So the goal is that it's sort of usually an acceptable way to choose the threshold, because you can normally say, depending on the experiment, 1% is reasonable, or 20% may be reasonable. It kind of depends on what you're doing. Typically, I think if you're going to report, if the punchline of your paper is, this is what's different, you might really want like a 1% threshold, because you want that list to be really true. If you're just generating a hypothesis, you can go and test a bunch of stuff downstream, 20% is probably fine, right, if you're going to go. So it sort of depends on your use case.
Do you ever like factor in what your p-value distribution is as you think about setting your FDR, or is the FDR of 10% always correspond to a certain p-value cutoff?
No, so it actually depends on the p-value. It does depend on the p-value distribution.
So when you're processing your data, do you ever first start by looking at what your distribution is like and then gauging that to say, okay, in this experiment, it's better to use an FDR of 10 versus 20, or how does that work for you?
That's a good question. So I think normally, if you look at your p-value distribution, it should typically look something like this.
Mm-hmm.
It should be reasonably flat. If it is like terribly skewed to one way or the other,
right? Yeah.
So that first of all means that the q-value FDR calculation is not going to work.
Oh.
Because it actually assumes that you have well-behaved p-values.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't have well-behaved p-values, it means that your statistical test is making some assumption that's probably false.
Okay.
So your p-values are not, since your p-values don't look reasonably like this, they're probably not valid. And as a result, the FDR calculation will also not be valid.
But this example here where you have like just the very tail end on the left showing the significantly different genes,
exactly.
That would be okay for an FDR distribution?
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
But sometimes you get p-value distributions and like everything is like up here, or like completely up here.
Okay.
In which case the test you're doing is probably not great for whatever the data is. And you can't trust really the p-values of the p-values.
But I mean, let's say if 10,000 of your genes are differentially expressed, wouldn't you get p-values that are all going to be on the left?
Yes, but I'd say if that's the case...
It depends on the total number of genes that
yes.
are differentially expressed, right?
Yes.
The p-value distribution.
So I guess if you believe in your system that 10,000 things might be changing at 20,000, then I think maybe you can trust it. But typically, yeah, so I guess you need some knowledge of the biological system. To know what this thing should look like.
Yeah.
Because one of the things the FDR calculation tries to do is to, by essentially looking at the shape of this thing, it tries to estimate what the proportion of true positives should be. So in this case, you could sort of look at this and say, well, it's not what it does, but by eye, like, you know, this is sort of nothing. And there's some bump up here.
Mm-hmm.
So this is probably the true proportions is probably in the order of, you know, whatever that size is. So yeah, so if you have 10,000 things that are really different, this would be skewed up, and you get, you know, it might say that 70% of your genes are differentially expressed. Which, if you believe that's true, then I think you're okay. But yeah, it is often a good idea to look at these distributions, see if they look like what you think they should look like.
It's a hard question. So let's say you're looking at 20,000 measurements.
Yeah.
And generating your p-value test. So q-value, so does the accuracy of q-value
mm-hmm.
increase with a larger p-value data set? Like, does it depend on that? Like, because q-value takes into account all your p-values in this.
So I think you probably need to be at least in the thousands.
Okay.
Once you're above thousands, I don't know if it makes much difference if you have, you know, 100,000 versus 1,000.
Okay. So in this situation, you had 20,000 genes,
yeah,
a bunch of replicates. Now, what if you had only 5 genes, but many, many replicates?
Mm-hmm.
Would this also work? Would this be a...
So I'd say if you only have 5 genes, you probably don't need to do the false discovery rate kind of calculation.
Okay.
Because the fault discovery becomes valuable
got it.
If the Bonferroni is going to kill you
sort of
your significance.
And when you say an FDR of 10%, does that always equal the same p-value, or the p-value is different in the way the math works out? You get to the 10% with different p-values.
Yeah, so it depends on the exact distribution of this thing. Yeah.
Okay.
So there's no direct correspondence automatically.
Okay.
Yeah, so you have to do it for every experiment.
Okay, so I think that's all I was going to say on false discovery rate type procedures, unless there's any other questions.
One more question.
Yeah.
So if you now had your q-value at 1%,
yeah.
what would you get, like, if you were to run that same thing?
This thing here?
Yeah, like, do you know what the outcome was? How many genes would you actually detect, et cetera?
Is it 1%?
Let's be a little close.
It's running. Take a second.
Yes, good question. So in this case, I think we'll probably still do
zero.
Exactly. So basically saying the differences are not large enough that I can give you any set that has a 1% false discovery rate.
So you have to go higher than 8 as a differential between what you added?
Exactly. If I added something higher,
then
I get some super extreme p-values,
yeah.
And exactly, and probably more significant q-values, and it would probably give me something there.
So changes have to be much
more. Exactly. So depending on how big the changes are, you sort of have to accept. So in this case, we can't be this stringent on false discovery. We have to accept something. We have to accept more false positives to report anything. So, anything else? Cool. So, what do I have left? 20 minutes?
Don't worry about time. You can go.
Go until noon. It's fine. Don't worry. People have nothing else to do.
We have a practical after this, but that I can always move it to Thursday. I mean, this
okay.
is more important
yeah.
to get the concepts
okay.
in.
No, I think 20 minutes is probably about good. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about normalization, which is like a separate from hypothesis testing. And typically you have to do it before you can even do your hypothesis test. Because you know that those count matrices I put up before? That was essentially assuming that you can compare the data in one column to the next column, which is not true if there's some technical reason that some numbers are like twice as high as the other ones, right? So we have to do some sort of normalization to make our samples comparable to each other. So I'm going to focus on RNA-seq data. Similar concepts apply to many other things. And depending if we have time, I could touch on sort of ChIP-seq and other things later on. So you may have heard of, you know, these RPM, reads per million measures. There's a measure called RPKM. And I was just going to outline, maybe on the board, so what these things mean and when they work and when they don't work. Let's see. Maybe I will turn this off. Excuse my poor handwriting, because I can't write any better. Okay, so imagine that we're looking at, in this case I'm just looking at four genes. There's another 20,000 rows, but I'm not showing. In this case, I'm only looking at three biological replicates. So in this case, the number here represents the number of RNA sequencing reads you got corresponding to that gene in a given sample. And imagine at the moment that there's no difference between these samples. So biologically, it's exactly the same thing. But for whatever reason, the read counts here are way lower than for those two guys. Right? It could be because, I don't know, the library didn't get prepared as well, or the sample got sequenced less. But whatever it is, there's some reason that you have way less reads here. So if I take the total number of reads I've got in each sample, these guys have 140 reads each, distributed across the genes like this. This guy only has 40. So one of the normalization assumptions people make is that the total amount of transcript present for each sample should be the same. Right. And you can question whether that's true or not. It's probably very often not true. But the reason people make that assumption is that typically if you don't make it, you're worse off than if you do make it. So if you assume these guys should have the same amount of total transcript, then the difference between 14 and 140 is just like a technical artifact, and you want to normalize that away. So one way you can do that is to essentially scale all these numbers up or down until your total read count is the same. Right, so this guy here just gets multiplied by 10, all those read counts. And if you do that in this case, you can see that the numbers will then match up, and things are pretty good, because we know, magically, that these samples are actually the same. So what reads per, and that's essentially what the reads per million transformation is doing. It takes each of these numbers and divides it by the total number of reads seen for that sample. Right, so it's saying, like, essentially it's saying what percentage of the reads come from this gene, what percentage come from that gene. And across all of these guys, those percentages are going to be the same. Right, because you're essentially scaling for the total number of reads. Which works, so it's called a scaling normalization, because you're essentially scaling all the numbers up, all the numbers down. And it works well as long as you have a linear amplification across all of your genes, which often is not the case. But if it did, that would be would help. So I think the idea with this RPM is that it's certainly better than doing nothing. There's a couple of cases I'm going to highlight where it sort of fails. So that's RPM. So RPM lets you scale the numbers such that you can compare gene A across the different samples. It doesn't help you if you want to compare gene A to gene B. But sometimes people want to know what are the highly expressed genes in this sample. And there's basically two reasons that this six, that this gene A might have higher read counts than that gene there. So ignoring sort of technical things like, you know, there's some weird PCR bias stuff going on. So the real biological reasons those counts might be different. One is that you have twice as many transcripts for gene A, which is probably what you're thinking about. The other thing is that gene A could just be much longer than gene B. Because if you're doing whole transcriptome sequencing, right, you're essentially, if this is gene A, this is gene B, and gene A is just a longer transcript than B, when you randomly pull sequencing reads, I'll use this one. So imagine this. Two copies of transcript A and two copies of transcript B floating around in my library. And I'm going to generate sequencing reads from these guys. You know, one read here, one read here, one read here, one read here. Because you're essentially just randomly sampling bits of these cDNAs. And so these are the transcripts. Down here I'm representing sequencing reads. So because this is shorter, you're just going to get fewer reads and smaller counts here, right? Which is why it's dangerous to say that this is more highly expressed than this, because you don't actually have more transcripts. You have more cDNA length, which is typically not what you're trying to quantify. You want to quantify the number of transcripts. So that's where this RP, thank you, where the K comes in. So the K is essentially normalizing for kilobases of transcript length. So you take each of these numbers, you divide it both by the total amount of sequencing in the sample and by the length of the transcript you're looking at. And if you do that, you're essentially normalizing for both sequencing depth, transcript length, and in that case, those numbers after scaling should be roughly the same. And you can say that they have these two genes have the same number of transcripts present. So the goal of doing RPKM is basically so that you can try to get closer to an absolute quantification of, you know, the transcript number, or at least the relative transcript number across different genes. it's in practice it's very difficult still, because you often don't know exactly what the transcript length is, because it could be a bunch of different isoforms, it could be a mix of isoforms, and depending on which isoform is present, this length of the transcript that you should be using to divide by is something you don't fully know. Right? And if that transcript length changes from sample to sample, right, that's another factor. So in practice, it's actually quite difficult to do this really well, which is why I think a lot of sort of, I guess more sort of more statistician-oriented bioinformaticians often end up working this with these RPMs and saying, we're going to compare gene counts across samples, and we're not even going to try to make comparisons within a sample across different genes, because we know it doesn't work very well. And if we can avoid it, we're not going to try to say that this gene is much higher than that gene. I mean, in some cases, it's obvious. If this is like, you know, 1 million and this is 2, it's probably safe to say that they're different. If it's like 2-fold or 3-fold, I'd be a lot more hesitant to say that there's something going on. So maybe if you want to pick, you know, one of the 1,000 most different, those 1,000 most expressed things, it's probably okay to make statements like that at that sort of very broad level.
Can you, coming back to the how depth impacts and for the scaling option?
Yeah.
You gave the example of like dividing everything by a million.
Yeah.
But in the end, S1 to S2 still has a tenfold difference.
Mm-hmm.
Are you, in the end, what happens, are you dividing by the column sums to kind of normalize that difference out?
Sorry, yes, actually. So when I said per million, I mean per million counts in that sample.
Okay, got
yeah,
it.
So
yeah,
actually, you normalize it by the column sums. Yes,
okay.
Very good point. So imagine this one is 14 million. This is, once you add up everything, 40 million reads here,
uh-huh.
140 million reads there.
Yeah.
You divide this guy's by 14. And this guy by 140.
So then that way everything is now on the same.
On the same, yeah. So
yeah,
it's the number of million reads in that sample.
Yeah. Okay.
So you don't even need to, you can actually just divide by the column sums. You can divide by the number of reads in the sample.
Yeah.
The reason
okay.
people divide by the number of million reads is that the numbers are more manageable.
Okay.
Because you divide this by 14 million, you get something lots of zeros, which is kind of hard to work with.
Got it.
But if you divide it by 14, you can actually, it becomes like a work easy to use number.
Got it. And then the tug of war that I was struggling with is, you know, when you look at the raw data,
yeah,
that could have been a real biological difference, that there was a tenfold difference, but then you normalize out and you damn it, that's also, what's your approach to that? How do you think of that? You need to normalize, I guess, knowing the way this behaves, but.
So you basically approach it by blindly assuming that this whole transcript amounts is exactly the same,
uh-huh.
even though you know it's probably not. And I think the reason for that is that even though there are often differences in the number, the transcript abundance between samples,
uh-huh.
but those differences are often smaller than the technical variability you see in like sequencing depth, because your library works better in one than the other. So essentially, you're accepting some bias to try to eliminate an even larger bias.
Mm-hmm.
In this way, you usually think about it.
Okay. Yep. But if your assumption holds true that the number of reads was equivalent between the number of transcripts, starting transcript was the same, then that biological difference would still be preserved even after the normalization step. Is that true?
But you said, so there's no biological difference then? Because the number of transcripts were the same?
The number of transcripts in tumor was the same as the number of transcripts
yeah.
in normal, but then that tenfold difference for gene A, that would be preserved if that assumption was true, right?
Yes, if there was a difference for DNA.
Yeah, okay.
Yes,
right,
yes.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. So this is kind of a fun example because there are no differences.
Mm-hmm.
Right, but if this was higher, that was a 9 or something, yeah, so that difference would now be preserved after you do this.
Yeah, that's making sense. Okay, yep.
So when I've seen this reported, it's FPKM.
Yeah.
What is
and
the
TPM?
Yes.
What's an FPKM?
And what's a TPM?
Oh, TPM, exactly. So, good question. So R is for reads, T is for transcripts, and F is for fragments. So sometimes for this you can do, imagine you do paired unsequencing. You get two reads coming from the same fragment, but really it's the same biological entity. So probably what you want to be counting are the number of fragments, not the number of reads. Yeah, so this is probably and sometimes people use them somewhat interchangeably.
Yeah.
not what you're like talking about fragments, but they actually use R, not entirely clear. But I guess what you want to be counting is the number of molecules that are there. And if you happen to have two reads coming from the same molecule, you still want to count them just once. Which is why fragments is probably a good one. And then transcripts is essentially the same thing as fragments.
Can the FPM be equal to the RPM if you're doing a single pair?
Yes, often exactly, which is one of the reasons people start to swap them and not have to differentiate very, very carefully. So when you do transcripts per million, that could actually be slightly different, because with fragments, you might have many different fragments you've sequenced from this transcript, whereas this is trying to get to how many of these original molecules were there. And one of the ways you can get there is by doing this length adjustment. Right, so if you have, you measure three fragments, and you know your transcript is a certain length, that corresponds to, you know, a certain number of fragments, a certain number of transcripts. If you have three fragments and your transcript was twice as long, it's going to be a smaller number of transcripts. And actually, the other one you see sometimes is CPM, which stands for counts per million.
Yeah.
And there, so this tends to be like the statistician version. It's saying that you're counting something. I don't care if it's reads, I don't care if it's fragments. You have some count in each of these things. And I'm going to compare these counts across the rows. And if you're comparing across the rows, it doesn't actually matter if you're looking at RPKM, FPKM, TPM, CPM, because these are all comparable. Right? If the transcript is longer, well, assuming there's no huge isoform differences, this is a really long gene, it's long in each of these. If I did paired end for here, I did paired end there as well. So it doesn't actually matter what they are, as long as you're looking within a single gene. So all of these differences only start becoming important when you're looking comparing this gene to this gene. Because otherwise you're essentially adjusting. Everything is consistent within the rows. Yeah.
In the case of paired end reads, do you consider each read as an independent read? Or do you consider entire two reads as like one fragment? And that's what you consider for the calculation.
So you like one of the assumptions of the processing is that they match together. Because when you align them, you align them together, assuming that they came from the same fragment. They shouldn't map, you know, super far apart, for example.
But I guess you're saying, what if you have some leftovers of some read?
So typically we just, if I have any read ones that don't have matching read twos, I typically just throw them out.
Yeah, okay. That's what you do.
Or assume that something went wrong in the pre-processing and they got lost somewhere, because that should usually not happen in practice.
And in the end, the whole purpose of normalization when dealing with such large data sets is to account for the technical artifact component, is that a fair statement?
Yes, exactly.
So
yes.
This is our attempt to account for technical variation.
Exactly.
In order to discover biological variation.
Yes, exactly. Because assuming that the biggest driver of differences is almost always technical. And if you don't adjust for it, it sort of completely swamps your biological signal almost always.
I see. And then in the end, the way you actually do it, is not the column sum, but like quintiles per column or something like that? Is that like more complicated and not sort of?
Actually, that's a good, very good segue, because I actually wanted to do that.
Okay, next.
So one of the issues with this column sums, like RPM normalization, is that it works well for the scaling situation, but imagine now instead that this, you had some weird like TCR craziness happening, and this one gene in this one sample gave you some super high recount, right? Because for some non-linear technical thing that RNA-seq experiments seem to like. So now, you don't have 140K anymore, you have something, I don't know, really big. Something huge. So now if you do your column sums normalization, this is really big, so this divided by this is going to be tiny.
Mm-hmm.
So now all of a sudden, all your genes other than this one have like super low expression values.
Mm-hmm.
In this one sample. which is not true, because we know in this case that there's actually, there should actually be no difference. So an alternative to doing this column sums normalization is a method that's implemented in this package in R called dseq2, which I think you guys will see, and may have seen already. And this makes a slightly different assumption. Instead of assuming that the total read counts should be the same, it has a slightly different. Essentially what it does is it assumes that most genes in these samples will not be differential across from sample 1 to sample 2. So if you assume that most things are not going to change, just some small subset, you can take advantage of that by doing this procedure. So first of all, we calculate it's called like a target sample, which essentially is like a median sample. So for each gene, I just take the median value across the row. So in this case, this is 60, this one is going to be 30, and this one is 20.
And what does it use? RPMs, RPKMs? Like what does it do when it's trying to create that? Do you know?
Normally you just take the raw read counts.
So the raw read counts.
Yeah, whatever the read counts, whether they were, you can actually do it on anything. If you had fragments or RPM, or often just counts per million. Whatever the counts that came off, you just do it straight on that matrix.
Okay,
so now this is your target, like your median sample. And now you're going to say, for each real sample, how does it relate to the target? And you essentially just ask for each gene, you're going to divide this number by whatever the target is. So this is 60, this is 3 over 30, this one is 60, this one is. So you're essentially asking, what's the ratio of this sample to this median sample? And essentially what you'll get, if I fill in some of these, so for this, the medians are all about 0.1, right? Because this sample one is about 10% of the target always. For sample two, they're all roughly one. For sample three, this first gene is kind of crazy. It's up at 100, and everyone else is roughly at one. So then what you do is you take for each sample, I say, what's the median of those ratios? So the middle value in this case is going to be 0.1, that is going to be 1, and this one is going to be 1. Right? And then what you want to do is scale your numbers such that these median ratios are equal to 1. So this guy,
don't you do it for each gene? No, you're doing it for the whole set of genes.
Is it, yeah, so basically, so these, you calculate these ratios gene-wise.
But why do you do it for the whole set instead of for A, B, C, D, you're calculating it for the entire set. Why is that? What's the... Why don't you do it for each gene? I'm confused, yeah, sorry.
For each, let's see, so you agree that I've calculated, so how I got this row?
Yeah, I got it, yeah, no problem.
And then you're wondering, like where does this come from?
Why are you doing it that way?
Because the assumption is that these ratios, if there was no technical bias, should be close to one. Assuming that if you say most genes don't change, the median ratio should just be one. Right. In this case, we systematically undersampled everyone, so the median is 0.1. So these guys need to be scaled up times 10. These guys are okay as they are, and these guys are okay as they are.
And you've now gotten rid of that 100.
Is it? So actually, yes. So this guy, so this 100 is still a problem in the sense that this is still measured really high. So it looks like for this individual gene, you have super high expression in one sample. But it hasn't messed up all your other data.
Yeah.
That sort of thing. So it's sort of saying you can't recover, this measurement didn't work. You can't really recover it. But that's, we're going to accept that as long as we don't kill everything else, which is what happened if you do the counts per million adjustment. So basically, it's more robust to artifacts in individual genes, which tend to be quite common. Because often when you have batch effects, for example, from one batch to another, it very often affects only a subset of the genes and not all of them in the same way. So if you had a batch of, so imagine, yeah. So I guess one type of batch effect is this to this, right? This batch just has less reads than this one, which is easy. But another very common one is like this thing here, where there's some small subset that for some reason didn't work well. And it could be that this gene has a particular like type of GC content, and the conditions in one sample favored like high GC content versus low GC content or something. So whatever the subset of genes that matches that criterion is going to be wacky.
So what should be the approximate sequencing depth you agree upon? Because sequencing depth,
mm-hmm.
if it is like significantly lower,
mm-hmm.
then I'm going to see like low expressed genes are not there. I don't get any reads from the low expressed genes. Right, so in the other sample, say S2, S3, there are like 40 million reads I get, so that should be sufficient to cover the entire transcriptome. Right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So if S1 has only like 5 or 10 million, so do you accept that set or just completely reject it?
So I guess, good question. I guess it depends on how much you care about the low-level transcripts. Some people do RNA-seq and they do 100,000 reads per sample. And they say, we capture all the highly expressed things, that's all we care about. And maybe that's OK, if you really only care about the highly expressed things. I guess statistically, it's hard to answer, because it depends on what kind of effects you're trying to capture. I do think it's a problem if you have huge differences. If all the samples were at 14 million, I think that's probably fine. If you had 10 that were at 14, and the rest that were 140, I think that could be a systematic problem, because all your lowly expressed things are going to start showing up with, actually this is something I haven't touched about, you can get a lot of zero. Once you start getting zeros in your data for lowly expressed things, like this scaling is not going to help you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like you can't scale up from zero.
Mm-hmm.
So anything that was at a zero to start with is going to be a problem in your downstream analysis. So it's actually one of the things we're sort of research-wise trying to deal with, like how do you handle all these zeros, especially in single-cell RNA-seq, it comes up a lot because your detection is pretty poor. So you often might detect, 3,000-4,000 genes in one cell, and maybe 6,000 in the next, and only 1,000 in the next one. And then you have a real issue with trying to scale, because everything that was a zero is still going to be a zero.
Yeah.
And what can you say about those differences?
So what is the average sequencing depth? You see that generally. Is it 30 million reads are okay?
For bulk?
For RNA-seq, yeah.
For bulk RNA-seq?
Entire transcriptome.
So I think if you just want to get counts of, like gene counts, like for each gene, if you don't want to do transcript discovery or anything like that, just like drill, I think 10, 20 million reads typically works very well, for example. If you want to discover new transcripts, then you want to be closer to 100 million. Because it's very hard to piece together isoforms without tons and tons of data.
So coming back to this example where you row normalize and then column normalize.
Yeah.
I guess I'm having a little difficulty understanding how, in the end, you can just take one of your columns after looking at the data and then multiply that whole column by 10,
mm-hmm.
and then not do the other column. That's what you practically would have done there. Applying everything across the entire matrix, that makes a lot of sense, but.
So what I would have done is actually divided everything by this factor. This guy's either divided by 1, this guy is divided by 1. Yes, so each row is going to get divided by whatever this number is.
Each row is going to get divided by that, yeah.
Each column.
Each column, yeah.
So these guys get divided by 0.1. These guys get divided by whatever this is, which
that
might be 1.07 or something.
Okay.
Yeah, so you apply the same. So each row column gets normalized by its own scaling factor.
So you wouldn't just multiply by 10 to column. So then that would be a column median normalization.
Yes, exactly. And this it is because it's happened to be 1, there's no transformation, but I guess I still divide it by 1. Yeah.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Anyway, so this is what's implemented as DSeq2 package, which I think you'll probably run, which works pretty well and is pretty robust.
Can you make a comment on how do you think about whether or not you need to log transform the data?
So for all of this stuff here,
you
actually don't need to do any log transform. The log transform comes in when you actually want to do your statistical test.
Right, yes, for your p-value, right.
Exactly, because now if you want to compare, so if you want to compare, you know, these two samples versus these two samples, the test you're doing is going to assume that these numbers have some sort of distribution, and typically it assumes some sort of, say you're assuming some sort of normal distribution. Log transform counts often look somewhat normally distributed, whereas the actual counts themselves definitely do not. So if you do the, so basically if you do a test that is like a t-test that assumes normality on the counts, you'll get totally skewed p-values because it doesn't meet the assumption of the, well, I guess what they expect the random numbers to look like.
Like the log transform would help your p-value calculation when you have this like 6,000, for example, it would tend to make the data more tight, but how do you know sort of when you're looking at your matrix whether for your p-value calculation you want a log transform or not? What's your approach to that?
So I guess there's two main approaches. So if you do something like, say, DSeq2, it actually, so this DSeq2 actually models the counts directly. So it uses a negative binomial distribution, which is a way of modeling counts. So that doesn't need to do the transform. Whereas if you use, there's another package called Voom that people use a lot. Voom essentially uses a t-test approach. And if you're doing a t-test, you have to log transform the numbers. So I guess it directly corresponds. So in a sense, you almost don't even need to look at the values. Depending on the test you're doing, you'll either need to log transform or not.
Okay. So what was the stat DSeq uses?
DSeq2 uses a negative binomial distribution, which once counts directly. So if you log transform and then give it to DSeq2, it'll give you nonsensical results.
All right.
Likewise, if you use Voom, which expects log transform and you don't, it'll also give you nonsensical results.
DSeq won't accept anything but raw counts because it'll give you an error in the first place saying that the matrix has to be, not normalized, and that's why you can't give RPKM or RPMs to it.
Okay, because it knows that it wants to be working on counts. So I think if you give it something that has like
decimals
or negative values, it's going to think you've done something to the data. And I think as a check, they just put in, it just gives you an error because they say you must have done to your data, it's not going to work. Which I guess they put in because people often do that by mistake, so it's a very helpful like check. That's all the stuff I have. Yes.
Yeah. So if I have two samples, control and sample, and then I looking at the peaks of the RMC data. So is it possible that the peaks in the control are different than the peaks in the sample?
So for RNA-seq?
Yeah.
So the peaks in terms of?
Like you pile up, so where I'm seeing the reads in the particular transcript.
Oh, yes, so looking at reads on the
yeah, reads.
Yeah.
So then I look at an IGV or like whatever.
Yeah.
Then is it necessary to have the reads, the peak should be aligned between the control and sample at this exactly the same place? Like ChIP-seq we see there, right?
Oh yeah, I wouldn't expect so.
Right?
No, necessarily.
Not necessarily.
Especially if you're doing whole transcriptome. They should be randomly spread throughout the wherever your exons are.
Yeah, I
don't think so.
So if you were to normalize the data for ChIP-seq, what would you do for that particularly before you call the peaks?
So I think before calling peaks, I typically wouldn't recommend any normalization.
Yeah.
Because in ChIP-seq, just really briefly, you usually have, you know, if you take your reads, you align them to the genome.
Right.
There's a peak here, some random noise, there's another small peak here. So essentially in ChIP-seq, you're going along the genome in Windows and asking, is there a place where lots of reads pile up relative to the surrounding background? And it's saying that, so in this window here, it looks like I have 2-3 reads, that must be the background. Given that that's my rate of getting random reads, how unlikely is it that I would have seen, 10 reads piling up in one place? If that's unlikely, I'm going to call this a peak. So essentially, you don't need to do any normalization because it's doing it internally by comparing each window to the adjacent windows, HFC.
But again, the sequencing, sorry. But the sequencing, the depth between different libraries could be different, right?
Yeah.
Right, so in that case, we have to normalize the data, right?
For HFC?
Yeah.
So so typically when you call peaks, you call them with sample by sample. So within each individual sample, you still don't need to. Because say you had more sequencing depth for the sample, it will probably give you a couple of extra reads here, and you know more reads here. So internally to the sample, right, it doesn't actually care if the other samples have more or less. Because this window here is still scaled to this window here, right? So and then once you've called the peaks within each individual sample, you can then compare those peak locations across samples.
And if you have to compare samples to samples, someone's, you know, for one particular kind to another kind? Because that question arises sometimes. They'll say like, oh, can you compare the peaks here to this other sample, like, you know, something, two experiments.
Yeah, which is actually kind of tricky because there's no, if you have much lower sequencing depth in one sample than the next, you're going to be less able to call peaks. So the fact that you don't have a peak present doesn't necessarily mean there's nothing about there biologically. It could be that you didn't have enough power to detect it because you didn't sequence enough. So I think typically if you want to compare peaks from one sample to the next, the best is to, you can call them against each other. Have you done max? Are you going to do?
Yeah. As opposed to first comparing to a background and then comparing to each other.
Yes, exactly. I'd compare one sample versus the next directly.
Yeah. That's what I do.
Could you comment in this workflow, do you ever use a Z transformation?
So for this...
Would that ever help you in some of these kind of...
Not necessarily, because it wouldn't really... Yeah, I guess it wouldn't really adjust those differences anyway. The Z-transform is useful mostly if you are, say, viewing the data. Because
mm-hmm.
say you want to make a heat map of this data.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that these values are so much higher than these...
Mm-hmm.
So I guess the issue is when you do your heat map, you often want to know how does this sample compare to that sample? But because the dynamic range from one gene to the next is so high, if you don't transform the data at all, you end up with all your highly expressed transcripts at the top, your lowly expressed transcript at the bottom, and you can't really see any difference from sample to sample.
Uh-huh.
Right, because this guy is like 10,000, this guy is 20,000, and this guy is 2, and this guy is 4. But on the whole scale, that goes from 0 to 20,000. These guys all look the same. So essentially what the Z transform will do in that case is to put each row on the same scale.
Same scale, right.
Exactly, right. By taking up, gives each row the same average value, which then lets you see sample-to-sample differences.
But so isn't that helpful when you're dealing with sort of these wide skews in abundance for transcripts? Or do you not find that helpful?
Not so much because each gene is essentially handled independently anyway.
Okay, yeah, okay.
Because after we do this normalization per sample,
uh-huh.
then you're testing those values versus that value. In a separate test, you're doing those values versus that value.
Uh-huh, okay, yeah.
So the fact that this row is different from that row doesn't actually affect the test.
Okay,
all right. All
right.
How do you say, for example, here gene A we have in S1, S2, S3, and we have control C1, C2, C3.
Yeah.
So how are you going to say that, okay, gene A is so many fold upregulated or downregulated? Because we didn't compare here the controls, right? C1, C2, C3.
Ah.
So how do I do that?
So I'll do exactly the same thing for the controls.
Okay.
So actually, you could just imagine that this is actually, it could just be like that. Yeah, so you basically put all the data from all six samples in the same matrix and just apply the same procedure regardless of the sample or just control label. Because actually at this point it should be agnostic to what the label is because it's only looking for technical differences which shouldn't be associated with your experimental groups.
And you still assume equal transcript reads throughout all samples. And so even if even if there was a change between S1 and C1, another gene would get more reads, and so they would all assume be the same? That's what I don't understand. Is right?
Yes, so normally the assumption is that some genes will go up in one sample, some genes will go down, but on average, they'll all be kind of... The average is that there's no global change, up or down, is basically the assumption. So this thing here, this could be a technical artifact, but it could also be a real change, right? So this case is super highly expressed, and which is why, even after you've done this transformation, that difference is still preserved. So that's a little bit the idea.
Yeah. What is most commonly reported? Is it p-value or the FTR for the each transcript? Like, what is the most common practice?
I think the FTR is more useful because the p-value is hard. I think it's harder to interpret. Because the p-value, to interpret the p-value, you need to know how many tests did you do. Did you test 20,000 RefSeq genes? Did you test 140,000, you know, encoded transcripts? And the p-value is a different interpretation in those cases, whereas the FDR will essentially take that into account and let you know. The idea is to tell you the confidence of your whole experiment.
Is that what the output of DC2 is? Is an FDR?
It gives, yeah, I think it gives you Q values,
okay.
Which is exactly the FDR Q values, yeah. Actually, it probably gives you P values too, but I'll tend to use the Q values. All right.
All right. So for this lecture, did you get the essence and everything, right? Mostly about the key things, I think, were sequencing-specific normalizations. So that, for me, I mean, p-value and all, yes, those are important concepts, but when you come for sequencing data, the kind of normalization you use is very important. The good thing is that now that you know what exists, you can make that choice for yourself. If you want to just do a simple RPM, sometimes that's okay if you're just making plots, right? And you just want a simple comparison of a fold change. So you can, you know, do an RPM for each sample and then just do a comparison with the means, literally for that gene across first three samples versus the other three samples if you just want to do a very, very basic comparison. But that said, DE-seq package, which we will go through the workflow in a few days, actually in a few weeks, that does that entire thing for you. So you just feed it a counts matrix, and then you specify what is the class or the group for what sample. So for example, treatment samples are sample 1, 2, 3, and then controls are sample 3, 4, 5, 6. And once you supply them that vector, it does that entire normalization as well as a comparison and outputs this nice little data frame that contains your genes, their p-value and the q-value and everything. And so that makes it very simple. Anyways, in terms of the code here, okay, so let's start with this particular part. That seems to be the first line of code. So the rnorm function is essentially a random normal function. If you want to see what it does, you can type rnorm here, and it'll give you I'm going to increase the font. So it gives you a little bit of background on what the R norm is. It should show up right here in your help. So there are these are the different types of normalization or random normal functions, which create a vector based on the parameters. So each of them requires, like, so here it requires n, the first parameter, which is the number of elements that you want to generate. And then the mean for that, and then the standard deviation, which is by default, the mean is 0 and standard deviation is 1. So here, if you do this, A is equal to R norm this, and you go and look at A, it's just five numbers who have the mean as 10. So you can see they're kind of centered around 10, and they're randomly generated for you. Okay, so that makes sense. You can try it again. And notice the second time the numbers are different because they're random. But there again, the mean would be approximately 10. It won't be exactly 10, right? So another function that you can do is, you can test what is the mean by using the mean function. And that gives you an approximate 9.9, which means that, yeah, it is close to 0, okay? To 10.
So then similarly, B, again, you're generating a similar vector. You can type B and see what the elements are. I would do a mean of B as well to see what the actual mean is. So this time, the mean of B is 10.004. The mean of A vector is 9.91. So they're both very, very close. Does that make sense? Is everybody with me? Okay. Then here, you're just basically subtracting mean A from mean B, which is what I did. You know the mean of A. And if you just see what the value for diff null is, it'll give you a minus 0.08. Like I said, it's very close. So under the null hypothesis, these means are very similar. So there is essentially no difference between these two means.
Can you remind me how you run a single line?
Yes, absolutely. So if you want to just place your cursor on anywhere on that line, and then just press Command Enter.
Command Enter. Thank you.
Okay. If you want to run a portion of the line, just select whatever portion you're interested in, and then again Command Enter. So it'll give you, if I just select B here and then press Command Enter, it gives me the vector. So you can run a portion of a line. If I just want to see the diff null, I do this. Select diff null and just press Command Enter. Okay?
Awesome.
Now the same thing for alternate hypothesis. I'll select the lines A and B. This time they'll be different. A is different. I want to see what A is. It's centered around 12 and B is centered around 10. And then let's see, just on our own, the mean of A is close to 12 and B is 9, and therefore the alternative difference is 2.64. Okay. Now, this is a code to run this test 10,000 times. So the only way to do that would be to run a for loop. Now, there is a library called foreach, which actually simplifies the for loop, which you may have covered last time, not the library, but the actual for loop command. So for I in 1 colon something something, do the step. Now for each just makes that syntax, that command a little simpler by saying, times the number of reps, which you have assigned to 10,000 here. So let's first load the library for each. So this is a good example of what to do when there is no package called for you. So I do not have the package for each. I assume you would not have that either. Okay, so then we go and try to see how we can install. So we go to tools and install packages. For any package that you want to install, you do that. Now there are two ways of installing a package. One is to go to the actual site of R or on Google and download this file, which is a tar.gz or .tgz. Or you can search the CRAN repository. And the way to do that is to select this CRAN repository here, and then search for, let's say, for each. Now, in this case, it actually exists, so it's already showing you, even before you complete, that for each is there. And then you just select install dependencies. Just leave this to default, because this is where you want your file to be. If you have another library, which I'm pretty sure none of you do, if you have, then select that path to wherever you want your libraries installed.
Sorry, I'm behind. How did you get to install packages? Where is that?
You go to tools, and then you go to install packages. And then this window pops up. Right?
Okay.
And I just installed that Knitter thing, so you can get Knitter there too.
Yes. So whatever packages are missing, just install that and then select this install dependencies. It'll install all the packages needed for that package to run as well. That's what it means. Alright? So I'm going to click install. It's going to run for a little bit. It's saying it's installing iterators, which is a dependency. And then here you see it installed, it received, downloaded, and installed. Everything is done. Let's try the package for each once more time, library for each. I'm going to run that command to see if it installed properly.
So mine is not installed properly.
Give it a second. All right. So everybody installed for each package? Yeah? Okay. So now I'm going to do library for each, and it says it's done, right? It didn't give me an error. That means it worked.
right? So you should have the similar output. You should be able to see this thing go revolutionanalytics.com, and that means it's done. So here we're initializing a variable number of reps. It's 1,000, 10,000. And then ignore the equal to part first. So don't ignore, because this is essentially the output of whatever is happening in these brackets, all right? So this is a particular syntax that is being used, which is saying that the times n reps, which is the number of repetitions, percent 2%, which means that, you know, it's an alternate way of saying for I in 1, 2, number of repetitions, do. Okay, so remember the syntax of the for loop from last time, right? So for loop is for a variable starting at whatever number to the number of times you want to do it, repeat some lines of code. Now, in the for each syntax, the everything within this bracket to this bracket is that same thing that you will execute inside the loop. That's inside the loop. But the actual syntax of the loop is just this much. So you don't have for I in 1 to n. You just say times number of reps. So times 10,000. This could be, might as well be 10,000. And then in brackets, this is just saying, ignore this part. So here, it could be 0, right? Do you see how this is just a shortcut way of doing the exact same thing that you want to do in a for loop? Does that make sense? No. Confused. Confused. Everybody is. That's okay. Own up. It's fine. I'm bad.
You can
be honest.
Where do you put the step size in that?
So the times, the 10,000, by default, the step size is going to be 1.
And if you want it to increment by 2.
That we can go into that. That's the syntax of for each. But for now, we just wanted to do it 10,000 times.
So the times is just like,
right, it's just an easier way to say this could also be written as for I in 1 colon 10,000 and then brackets and then this, all this stuff here and then but that's it and that's it and then this could the output of, and that would be it and then you can assign this diff underscore null to be the here. That's it.
So each time the loop runs, it outputs to div null, so you have
the total output for the entire thing would be that. And for each is just a faster output of that.
What does it produce, a vector?
So we can do that and see, like, what is the output of this, right? So to do this 10,000 times, it would take a long time, right? So now let's see what the diff null is. So this null, diff null is, yes, you're right. So it's every time it does that, it produces an output to this and stores it in diff null. And it has 10,000 tests of this mean A minus mean B. Okay, so diff null is now a vector that contains 10,000 elements. Is that? And I don't think it'll work like this here, because I don't think for loop has that functionality, but we can try and see. Just be prepared, it's going to take like 5 minutes to finish this, as opposed to a few seconds.
Why?
Because for loops, by general, are very slow. So by default, they're very slow, which is why for each was written as a faster way to execute these for loops.
Okay.
If for loops were fast, nobody would write a separate for each library. So. Okay, so this would probably give me an error. Right, so this what happened is that if I do an equal to here, it just assigned diff null as a function. It just creates a function, it doesn't store the output here. So in order to create an output, I will first have to create a vector here. And then assign it to nothing. And then here, I will say diff underscore null is equal to c diff underscore null comma mean a minus mean b. Okay, so without going into too much stuff, what I just did was I created an empty vector, and here I'm storing the output of mean a and mean b into diff null
which is updated every time the loop executes. And all of that is done in a simple command here. So you can see that for each simplifies that stuff for you. You didn't have to declare an empty vector. You didn't have to execute this for loop. You didn't have to write I in one colon 10,000. And you didn't have to put this as an equal statement here. Okay? So there are lots of shortcuts like this in R. You just have to realize that, you know, that there are shortcuts, so it'll take some time to follow what's going on, but they're useful. You can do the same exact thing in a much longer way, and that's perfectly acceptable. And I did that for a very long time because I was not comfortable with taking these shortcuts. So, all right? Okay, so you can execute this as, you know, on your own and see how it goes. But for now, let's move on. And so similarly, the alternative hypothesis is here. We test that. Pretty sure the diff null has been erased, so we'll do that. And now, so again, this code is a little dense. And I remember I mentioned once that Martin's code is usually dense because he does a lot of compact stuff in one statement. I had mentioned this a few weeks ago. In R, you can do that. But anyways. So now this is a plot function. We haven't covered graphics yet, so don't be alarmed. But plot is a simple way to put something on this on the output. And let's just copy this entire code and run it from start to finish as is. As you can see, this creates a plot right here. Do you see this? So let's start going into this backward. Remember I say you could try and, if you don't understand, go. So the first thing is text.color is black and red. So this is the text. And what it's saying is the color for the text should be black and red. Now, it also says that the legend at the top should be labeled with two things, which will be null and alternative. These are, the first one is null, the second one is this. And the colors for those are black and red.
And it's just the order that determines that?
That's exactly. So if you put alternative,
it'll reverse them.
It will, and, or, yeah, whatever else, and it'll just call alter and alternative. All right? And then the position is top right. You can also go top left. Again, play around, and you will see that this is, it creates another legend on the top left.
How much flexibility is there? Like middle, top, you know, bottom right?
You know, if you Google this legend thing, you will find out, in R, you will find out, you know, all the different possibilities on the graph. And which is why I like R, because it gives you all these options of doing stuff, you know, wherever you want. Lines is a way to plot lines. And then within lines, you're saying plot the density, call the density function, and plot the alternative vector here with the color red. Okay? So let's say I want the color to be blue. I can just run this command again, and it'll create a blue line on top of the red line. Like this. Alright? I mean, basically it plotted another blue line on top of the existing red line. Alright? And if I go back to red, it's not going to change it. It's going to try to plot another red on top of the blue, so it just gets darker.
Purple.
Yeah, it kind of gets purple. All right, so, and then the main is the heading, which is the difference distribution. X limit is the limit of the axis from -3 to 5. That's what you put. If you change this limit to something else, it'll modify the graph. And then you also want to plot the density of diff null. Notice here we did not specify the color, so by default it's black. If I wanted the color to be, say, blue, I could just put the same parameter in... Well, yeah, if I do after density color is equal to blue, so it redrew the plot with this, just this, and color as blue. Okay, this is just an intro on graphics. I will do some work on it, we'll tell you. But plot function is a very basic function for graphics.
Why didn't it just put it on top of the block like before?
Because we called the entire function again.
I see.
We called the entire plot function again. So it refreshed the state of the machine and the graph. Notice everything else that will plot, lines, legend, text, will be plotted on top of the stuff. So now you go lines, it plots that. You go legend, it plots the legend. And then the color,
it takes the color of the tensor. All right? Is that good?
And why is there no limit for the default? So
because I think
for everything, or,
huh?
Or is the x limit c to minus 3.5 for everything, or just for the diff null?
No, it's for everything, because once it creates that plot, that's
then
what the limit is used.
Okay.
And everything goes on top of that plot.
Okay.
So you define the boundaries in the plot function, and then the lines and all are plotted on top of that. Okay? With the same axis. So this is an introduction to graphics while we're going through the code. So then you can now calculate this sum over here as 0.051 versus this as e to the power minus 4. And then again, go through the for each code again to calculate the mean alternative, which will tell you how different they are. I thought we just went through this code. I don't know why it's written again. We can try it out anyways, see what happens. And then it's the same plot function. Till here. Okay. So I don't know, maybe he's doing it for some other thing. It's the same exact code, maybe the number of reps is different. Is that the thing? But it didn't say here. So let's go to multiple comparisons here. Here we're creating a matrix of random normal. Again, we're calling the random normal function, which we just covered, but we're not, by default, then the mean and the standard deviation is 0 and 1, respectively. So it creates 10,000 values times 6 in that matrix, so 10,000 rows and 6 columns, and we specify 6 columns here, so we'll have 10,000 rows by default. Do you understand this statement? So we're assigning it to DAT, or data, whatever you want to call it. That's the first step. Whatever is the output goes into DAT. Then let's go into the function matrix. Remember when we call the matrix function, it expects you to specify the number of columns and number of rows. If you don't specify the number of rows or number of columns and you specify one or the other, then it just takes whatever you specify and defaults the other to the, you know, respective. So for example, you're saying generate 60,000 random normal distributed numbers.
Okay.
That's what you're saying inside this. And then you're saying take that and then assign that as the first argument to the matrix, which means that now it'll have a vector of 60,000 elements. And then it says that take that 60,000 vector and then convert it into a matrix with 6 columns and whatever the number of rows. So that would by default be 10,000. Okay? Does that make sense?
Yeah. So if you put rows, 10,000, it would automatically do the columns.
Yes.
Okay.
It would make the columns automatically 6. It's just more stuff to type, and we don't want to type. Mm-hmm. So, and then here you're just saying the call names for the data, basically, if you're saying for this matrix, the column names are A1, A2, A3, B1, B2, B3. And you do a head on it, just like, it's like a less, and you're saying round that to 2. Let's say we don't do round, and we just run it. Then it will first of all say, what? But if you don't round them, they're just basically bigger numbers. All right? You're familiar with rounding, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's saying round it to 2 decimal places. That's all that's happening here. So it just makes it neater. Got it? Okay. So now we're doing the multiple testing example here. It's calling this gene filter library. What do you think will have it? We do. Does anybody else have gene filter?
No.
No.
Okay. So then install it via the packages and the way you do, and then you know, go through the rest of it like that. So pretty much, other than this, anything in the quotes line, don't execute that. But everything else, you can execute. If you try to execute the quotes, it's just going to give you an error, right?
Gene filter isn't.
It's not available. I don't know why.
It's not on CRAN.
No.
Okay. So then it'll be on a bioconductor repository. What you want to do then is go online and search for bioconductor. You go bioconductor. So bioconductor is this bioinformatics library for R. So it's essentially a collection of packages which are there. And if you go to bioconductor home, it basically gives you this tons and tons of packages. And so gene filter, in fact, DSeq is also on bioconductor. So gene filter will be a package on bioconductor. Okay. So if you search on this, on gene filter on bioconductor website, it'll show you that it comes up as one of the results here. It's a package. Click on that, and it tells you how to install it. The way to install it is to copy these two lines here, which first tell the R to source this from this particular URL. Can you see this? Here. So once you go to bioconductor.org, you search over here in the top, gene filter. Okay? Are you with me?
Yes.
I know I'm going a little fast, but just to cover more stuff. But you search for gene filter, and then when you search for gene filter will show up as multiple links. You click on the first link that shows up, and you will get these different, these set of things that tell you how to install. Now, the way to install is to copy these exact two lines, just like this, and see if it works.
So it says it doesn't have BioClite.
Right, so it doesn't have BioClite. Right. So BioClite is not there because, hold on. And so, install bioconductor. So, okay, all right, I guess I'll have to do this in detail, but if you go through the site and just basically try to see how to install BioClite, see if you can do this, source bioconductor.org/BioClite, just this command, oops, here. If you type this in your command window, what happens?
So just the top one?
Huh?
Just
yeah.
The top one.
Source bioconductor shed bioclite.r. Does that work?
Yeah, I think so.
Did that work for everyone?
Bioconductor version 3.2, yeah, I think so.
It worked?
Yeah.
Okay. So then, if you just do this, bioclite, what happens? Just this.
Empty bracket?
Yeah. It should give you something like this.
Mirror or something, something. Yeah.
Something, 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 red stuff, something, something, something. Mo, are you?
Yeah, I
you got lost?
Yeah.
Okay.
So
where were you last?
Well, I was trying to download gene filter.
Gene filter, okay. So gene filter won't download directly from this R studio.
Okay.
Because it's a package in bioconductor.
Okay.
So bioconductor, as I was mentioning, is a library for bioinformatics specific packages for R. Right? So while matrices, data frames, those kind of packages, they are for R. The statistical packages can also be for R, some of them are by default, but bioinformatics specific packages are found in bioconductor universe. So just like R has its universe, bioconductor is its own universe of bioinformatics packages. Now, in order to get access to this universe of packages, you need to first type this command. So this tells R that I'm going to source from this URL. So you notice how you specify this URL in this file, and so it then brings that file automatically from that website into your computer. That's what you just did with this command. And then you type bioclite. Now bioclite is like an install, like setup, or you know, just double click. You just, by saying bioclite in the brackets, you said, you know, install this or update this. And so it's asking me, a newer version of R bioconductor is available. Would you want to do this?
Could you just go up a little bit? And
sure.
Bioclite.r, okay, that's it.
Another way to look that up is to go online and just go to bioconductor website. So bioconductor.org,
mm-hmm.
And then you select install. And it should bring you here. the very first source here is this, these two lines. It says install the latest release of R, and then to get the latest release of Bioconductor, just follow the following commands. That's exactly what I've done. All right?
So both lines, you have to put both lines?
Yes, you'll have to do both of those lines. And then it'll ask you whether you want to up. I mean, I have done this before, so it's saying new version is available, blah, blah, blah. So I will just have to go through it. I'll select A to update. Does it say, does it tell you the same thing, old packages and this to you?
It's subtly, mine's subtly different, the red.
Yes, because I have other packages that you will not have because you're using it for the first time. So here, you will select A. So update all of those packages. Is everybody still with me? If you're not, select A and press Enter. And now wait. So this will take 15, 20 minutes.
So there is no hatch mark or anything with
Spot? No, just A and Enter.
Okay, yeah.
Now
mine
are you...
is not working. Mine is not working. I don't know why. It says can't. URLs are not supported. I don't know. It's not installing any of that stuff.
Okay.
Sure.
Maybe I can look at yours
we'll
after.
Yeah.
Yeah?
So
if that's installed, we can go to the gene.
Then you have to go BioCLite in brackets quotation mark gene filter. So that's the way to install from Bioconductor Universe. So it's like, say, instead of saying install, you say BioCLite. So right now it's going to keep updating and installing all these packages. Ideally, I should have done it later. This is what will happen. And once it's done, this is how you install stuff.
Okay, great.
So you can follow the rest of the commands in the tutorial once you install GeneFilter by following BioCLite. All right? So that's your homework. Now, the other important thing that I want you to go is to go to intro2bioinformatics.com and log into the course. So this is pretty important. Have you been checking the site, the course updates?
Mm-hmm.
So then on the site, in the last unit, or the unit before that, you should be having...
What to do for homework for the next 2 weeks?
Well, that and...
The R
programming book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if you have not downloaded that, please do so. And then we go through here. It should be in this intro to R programming nuts and bolts, right here.
I found it in Loopy, but it's all the
yeah,
same.
I put it there as well.
Oh, okay.
Right? So here you can get it. Under R programming control functions and loop, as well as an intro to R. And then you download the...
down below.
Below.
Yeah, you go.
Yeah, there you go.
R programming book. Okay?
There's a code that you can also download.
Okay. Cool. So this is the code file for this book. So you download that. You download the data sets. Put them in one directory. Once you have them, so they're accessible. And then... I want you to start doing these chapters, getting data in and out of R using reader package. I will try to briefly cover them because it's a lot of work to go through all of these. And the code files for these are in here. The code files are here. These will give you a very good, thorough learning of basic R. So this is not, in essence, I wouldn't consider this advanced R. It would still be very basic stuff, but you will get very familiar with how to get data in and how to, use these packages. And then on Thursday, when I do the session, I would like you to come with problems. What part of the data did not, which part of this did not work? Because of the lack of time, we won't be able to cover all of this if I start to go line by line. Or if I do, I'll go really fast and then you'll be like, well, I didn't get anything, which is, again, defeats the purpose, right? So please do this as a homework if you want to attend Thursday's next 2 Thursday sessions. Okay? I mean, so far I've been very lenient on the homeworks, right? But this is a must. Everybody must do these.
How far should we get in these problems?
As much as possible. I mean, there's no, we'll try to cover the, let's say, how about the first 4 in this Thursday and then the next 4 next Thursday.
And if we can't make it today,
yeah.
Should we still try and do this?
You must try and do this.
Okay.
So you can do this on your own. In the book, there are links to videos for the person who has written the book. He's put up videos. They're very helpful. I highly recommend going through those videos, and they're a lot shorter, so you can cover 15-minute intervals as opposed to watching 1.5 hours, which I know is a drawback, it's very hard to watch in one sitting. But those videos are shorter, you can cover them in, you know, 15 minute intervals, and they are there for each of these chapters you have videos. Okay? So definitely go to the first four. Next Monday we'll be going over controls, functions. So I would like you to, you know, cover as much of this as possible. If you can finish it, great. If not, cover as much of this as possible. I have not received your teams. You need to start doing your sequence data analysis for the final. I mean, it's not a graded final, but if you don't complete that, you will not get the essence of the course. The only way to learn and be successful is to do it yourself. And so you'll encounter a lot of problems, but that's good. Then you can come and, you know, ideally, I'd like to finish this, all of this, by May 21st. So we have around four weeks to go before, Memorial Day. That would be ideal. So, you know, so, I mean, we're trying to step up into high gear now. Form your teams. I need the names, just the name of whoever you're working with by the end of the day today. If you're working alone, that's fine. But just send me that I'm working alone.
Next Monday, what are you going to be doing? Are we going to
functions.
Functions is next Monday.
Functions is next Monday in R. Following that week, we'll try to do plots and heat maps. So, actually, no. Following that, we will do, functions, and then we'll do D-seq analysis, the differential expression, and then we'll do heat maps. So that takes 3 weeks out. And then finally, the last week, I think I will try to cover gene set enrichment and variant calling if we have time.
And at some point, David Ting's lecture, right?
Yes. I will ask him to. So we'll do like a 1-1 where the practical will be moved to Thursday. And then instead of the practical, we'll have a lecture, like, you know, sort of the discussion that we're having. And then I will try to utilize Thursdays as much as possible to cover additional stuff that, you know, would be helpful. If you can make it Thursday, it's great. If not, do watch the lectures, you know, that I'll post the videos online. There won't be a formal lecture, but we'll go over your problems, your details of anything that you haven't yet familiarized yourself with, right? And if, in case it turns out that we're not able to finish by Memorial Day, then we'll do a couple of lectures after. I absolutely have no issues. If you guys are around, we'll just do the lectures after. Okay? All right? All right.